Good afternoon, everyone, and it's a pleasure to talk to all of you in this Media Next event being organized by IDMS University. And I had the fortune of listening to the speakers before me, and we got a very good perspective of how political parties are looking at the future of communication. So as we will see, I will make a presentation and we will go over a few points. But yes, I mean, people were saying that development is going to be the future of communication. In fact, communication is going to be what development will be all about in the future. But that has come to reality even now, because we can see that while we are trapped at home, and like we heard from our former speakers, even political parties who like to be on the ground, who want to be with the communities, they are not able to do that right now. So they are also communicating digitally and trying to find new means or modes of communication. So yes, I mean, we work with children at Save the Children. And you might be, of course, knowing that 40% of India's population is children. So whether it is political communication or development communication, children are extremely important. And they are not just the future, as people say that children are our future. They are our present, because they are everywhere and they need support and they need to participate in the change that we want to bring about in our country. So we will take a look at communication in the post-COVID world, particularly development communication in the post-COVID world. But at the outset, I just want to mention that communication by itself is not going to change. The need for communication, or even what we want to communicate, is not going to change. But the mode and the mediums are going to change. And we realize now that historically in India, we had the caste system. We have to now be cognizant about how the caste system is going to play an important role also in terms of technology and making information and media accessible to the most marginalized, because the gap between the poor and the rich has been increasing rapidly in this country. And now with the migrant crisis and many other crises, including the economic downturn that we're expecting in the short term, the gap could increase even further. And the impact of such crisis is huge on children. Children, of course, depend on others for education, for health, and for their protection. And the children are the ones we really need to look out for as the most vulnerable among the people of our country. So I just want to mention to you that it was mentioned in the bio that there's a book that I wrote with Rashmi Bansal this year. It's called We Are the Champions. It's a book, again, which talks about stories of 15 children who struggled against very tough circumstances. But they did not only struggle to make their own lives better, but to help the community, the nation, and even the world a better place to live in. So we will talk again now about how the talk and what we say and who will say what in communication needs to change. So may I request the management to put on the presentation, and we can go over that. So we are going to talk about development communication in the post-COVID-19 world. Can we move to the next slide, please? So as everyone on this talk would definitely know that along with the pandemic, we've had an infodemic, because there's just been such a surfeit of information that it's becoming very hard for people to digest the information and to even make out what is accurate, what is inaccurate, and what should they rely upon in terms of credible information. So if we go to the next slide, the biggest question right now that we are facing in communication and media would probably be, are we giving information or are we giving disinformation? And in fact, there are many global surveys going around which tell us that, in fact, while media is the most often accessed source for information, particularly around COVID, people go to media even more than they go to governments or even the health organizations. They turn to media for information. But unfortunately, some surveys have shown that media in India is, in fact, very untrusted and not to be trusted, really, because India ranks in some surveys as the number two mistrusted media in the world. So why is that taking place? Why do we have such partisan views? And not just media, but even social media can be used by political parties, politicians, and even development organizations to present partisan views. And in fact, You may have seen that among your own social media friends, many people have divided further into two clear-cut lines where they support a cause or they're against a cause or they support a political party or they don't support a political party. And the fault lines have really emerged in a very rapid way. And that's going to have an impact on how we communicate in the future. So let's move on to the next slide, please. So yes, I mean, just more findings from different surveys. And we know that media is under pressure right now in the country. You all are all experts on media. We know that print media is literally on the edge of survival. And with circulation dropping dramatically, everyone is very concerned about jobs and even about the ad revenues and the actual life of a print publication. And so is broadcast media also under threat. In fact, we know that the older generation people, they kind of depend more on broadcast media or print media, and any kind of setback to those platforms would really make it difficult for them to access information. Let us keep in mind that when you talk about digital India and how we are going to go forward from here, even the BJP guest mentioned that elections, if they were to be held digitally, that's not a reality in this country. Like I mentioned to you, we have a caste system also in terms of media and technology in this country, where while we will have 500 million people in the country having smartphones by the end of this year, there are many, many more out there who need information even more regularly, but they don't have smartphones and they don't even have internet access, and they are really cut off from media and communication altogether. And they are the ones we really need to reach out to the most, but they are the ones who are the hardest to reach. And in fact, at Save the Children, we make it a point to focus on the most marginalized, because there are many other NGOs and other organizations which can reach people in big cities or where it's easy to access communities. But when it becomes really challenging is to find people who are really in remote locations and what their problems are. I think someone mentioned earlier today that listening is also going to be as important as talking and communication. In fact, more so now, because with physical distance really increasing in terms of people being cut off in terms of social distancing, we need to be able to find ways not just to tell people about what they ought to be doing, but to first understand what are their real needs and what are the priorities that we can work jointly with them to overcome. And one thing I just want to hint at right now, maybe it will come again in the presentation, is that I foresee that community communication or even behavior change communication or communication for development is going to play a very important role, because even in media terms, I feel that community-led media is going to play a bigger role, and people will want to tap into local and community information in a much bigger way than what media and communication was till now, when we kept talking repeatedly, parroting the same, news stories, featuring the same politicians or the same celebrities or the same sports people. We have to get more real in our communication now, because we are all connected, and we can't live in an urban scenario and think that the rural scenario does not affect us. Or we know that every country in the world is now connected, and every one of us, no matter whether we are rich or poor, or whether we are accessible to information, or if we are cut off from information, we are all connected. And what happens to each one of us impacts everybody else. And we'll talk more about empathy and how that will be a driving force of communication in the times to come. Can we go to the next slide, please? So, we have to really take on responsible communication now. And that is the challenge that all of us here on this webinar, we are all, serious media professionals. So I guess it's important for us to, not only for ourselves, but also to people that we interact with, and perhaps those we teach in media colleges and institutions, to let them know that, just doing a story is not the primary task of a journalist. I mean, historically, journalism was something which helped the community to grow and the country to become strong. And somewhere down the line, we have maybe lost track of that vision, and it's time to come back to reality and be responsible and be a change maker even as a journalist, because to just to find a breaking story and then go away from the issue to a new story is not the way out. We have to have sustained coverage and communication on issues to bring about lasting change. And like if you have a cyclone coming to West Bengal, you know, media from all over the world comes for the first one day, and then they find that, okay, the casualty count is not very high, but they do one or two stories and then they go away. But the actual work for helping the people to rebuild their lives begins after the landfall and after the media organizations have gone away. And that's where communication becomes vital. And we'll talk a bit more about that. Let's go to the next slide. So we need to really find ways to communicate more effectively. And I must look at my presentation on my computer once for one note that I need to find here. Just give me a minute. So we have had many lessons that we have learned. Lesson number one was that over-communicating is not a solution. Just bombarding people with information and what you want to tell them is not so useful, because we also heard that people's attention spans are diminishing very quickly. And unless an issue or any communication is directed towards them individually, it is not going to have them being attached to your communication for too long and will at least not prompt any action, because ultimately communication must connect and drive action. And I told you about empathy. So empathy is what is going to really help to drive action-oriented strategies and you know, build a connection from the heart, I would say, not just from the mind. And communication, of course, needs to be more you know, creative. It needs to cut through the clutter because everyone is now going digital. Even a business houses, restaurants, and hotels, and you know, hospitals. Everyone is now, in fact, even we are talking on Zoom. I don't think we would have really prefer to be on Zoom if we had a chance to have online or have a real physical meeting. But now we have become used to Zoom and Skype, and many organizations, even business houses, are thinking about how they can cut away from commuting time and the expenses of hosting meetings in a hotel or any other location to getting a virtual conference. So, but communication is going to be much more creative now. And I mentioned to you that listening is important. So two-way communication, how do we build those channels for two-way communication? When we're talking to people who are illiterate, perhaps, who are speaking a different language, how can we ensure that they are able to understand us and we are truly able to understand what they say? Because one more thing to understand in communication is that it's just not the people who talk the loudest or who are most visible on panel interviews on television who are the most knowledgeable or the experts or the only experts or the only voices that need to be heard. In fact, we know that, say the children, working with children, that sometimes the quiet children are the ones who are the most agonized, who need support the most. And in fact, they are the ones who have the most riveting stories to tell. But it requires patience and understanding and cooperation to spend time to understand them and to talk to them in a different way than we've been used to talking to people. So we don't bombard them with questions, but maybe go with an open-ended question and give them a chance to slowly start talking about what they really want to say. Let's move to the next slide, please. So disruption is here, and we have no choice but to adapt and scale up and offer better solution. And in the promo, I just told you all about how you know, the exciting world of virtual reality or augmented reality seemed very far-fetched, but you will see it coming much faster now, because communication has to be very exciting now and to, you know, keep people engrossed. And therefore, now we have 4G, then we have 5G, and hopefully more and more people go online, including people from communities, and we find ways to network with the people who are poorer and, you know, create tools that they can use. We will have much more advances in communication. And of course, video conferencing, online ads, or being on social media, which someone guest before me said earlier was sometimes considered to be a bit, you know, not so serious, is all very, very serious now. They're not good to have. We just have to adopt them if we really want to stay in the communication business. So let's move to the next slide, please. So there are, of course, tremendous activities going on. We know that even the government ministries, even the ministers are having virtual conferences and meetings. In fact, even Save the Children, we attend many of these meetings. And in fact, just a few days back, there was a meeting with Ashok Gehlot, Chief Minister of Rajasthan, and Save the Children brought up the issue of migrants and how migrant children need to also be factored in. So these are all great opportunities to interact with senior politicians, bureaucrats, and people who are the think tank and who are really going to drive the agenda of taking the country forward. So each one of us now has a greater chance to contribute our ideas. And but we need to talk about those ideas succinctly and creatively. For example, the Vietnamese song and dance about hand washing, that went viral all over on social media. So it was like interesting, it was fun, and it had a nice message. And hopefully we'll see in the next few slides also a video made by one of our own children, one of the champions that we work with in Delhi. His name is Sumit, and he also is featured in the book, We Are the Champions, that I wrote with Rashmi Bansal. And Sumit has made a rap song in his slum, for his slum in Delhi to talk about hygiene practices. And that actually was shown on NDTV and is being also used on other platforms. And of course, we know about the Aarogya Setu app. We know about the gov.in website, which is also a very much two-way communication. We really need to see the opportunities and create interesting content. But the need is for simple communication. And the overarching theme is not really about the future or something very grand. It's all simply about how do we save our lives? And if we can make it pertinent to the individual and their family and their household, that's when we're going to attract attention. So the Apna Ghar Bachao is one more idea that has taken wings. And that's the kind of core messaging that we need to adopt now to ensure that people stay tuned into what we are saying. So the challenge is that communication for people with little or no access to digital platforms, that's the immediate challenge. Of course, we will have many more apps coming out, many more tools coming up. We will have many other platforms and opportunities, but let's see how we can adapt such things. So there are some questions. You want to take them now, or we can wait for them till the end? I find Sulekha has raised a hand. So either we move to the next slide and take questions at the end.
Questions only to be taken. Amrish sir.
Mr. Tak, I am Amrish Saxena. I am moderating the session. So I was listening to your presentation very carefully. One thing which definitely I would like to ask, the kind of change that you talked about is going to happen after post-COVID. And we will be more in the virtual spectrum than the real. Obviously, then we will go with both, with the offline and the online mode in our communication in the social sector, particularly in the development sector. But then what kind of situation you foresee, whether this whole virtual communication will be a substitute to the communication in the real world, or it will simply add on with the kind of communication that we have already been having in the conventional form?
So that's a very good question. Of course, there's no easy answer, but there are two aspects to it. Number one, I also mentioned that communication by itself is not changing. The need to communicate and what we need to communicate is not changing. So that will not change. But yes, how is communication going to become more virtual? Of course, if you read science journals, you will see that people even talk about how humanity itself is under threat because artificial intelligence might at some stage, 100, 200, 300 years down the line, really become so overwhelming and so powerful that there may not be a need for a biological form like a human being. But again, coming back to your topic, I mean, for example, I have my son, he's 18 years old now. So there are many of these games that people are playing. I forget the name of the game right now. There are many games that you have online gaming. One game called Fortnite. It is so huge, one of the biggest businesses around the world these days. And in fact, when there's a music label launch, it is launched on Fortnite because they have got so many young people playing that game around the world that's the ideal platform. And so you find, you know, despite my telling my son not to be on the game for so many hours every day, I mean, it's a kind of addiction because all their friends are playing that game. Now, my son, you might say, is going to comes from a more privileged background, and he's got friends who have access to internet and to gaming software and other payment mechanisms to purchase items online. But yes, I mean, ultimately, we know that Facebook also has penetrated to every strata of the country. And I mentioned to you that, yes, there is a caste system in the country. And while we have poverty, and the poverty is under more threat of increasing in these times, but ultimately, if you look at the big picture, yes, there are companies which are going to bring out many more products, which are going to be much more reasonable and much more easier to adopt, and will not require sophisticated training to adopt. So yes, I feel that virtual reality, augmented reality are going to take over a lot of our communication in the future.
Yeah, another part of your presentation wherein you talked about the responsible communication. We all who are in the field of communication always try to make sure that whatever we are communicating that has to carry some meaning. Now, how will you elaborate further on this, particularly for the benefit of those who are joining now in the communication industry, particularly the students and the budding communicators? What will you suggest to them? How can they be sure that whatever they are communicating is meaningful and is benefiting the society?
So when we talk about fake news, for example, the biggest trick to overcome fake news is to double check facts. So before you share something, before you like something on the social media, it is wiser to double check whether that is a fact or a fiction. And like I told you, we are living in very controversial times where even political parties, politicians, even development organizations, business houses are using the digital platforms to further their perspectives. So sometimes we find that there is sometimes a fake news or a fake information floating around. So I think it's important for any person coming into communication or media, like our job right now really is to ensure that there is credibility. Because I told you how Indian media is right now ranked number 2 in the world in terms of being the most untrustworthy media in the world. It's a very dishonorable thing. I might tell you that when I was in Nepal, when the earthquakes took place, 4 or 5 years ago, a lot of Indian media turned up there to do the coverage, and the kind of coverage they were doing was so different and ridiculous compared to what the global media was showing. For example, I mean, they were showing dead bodies, talking to children whose father is being carried for cremation about how he is feeling about the earthquake. So complete lack of sensitivity. And in fact, the Nepalese population said, go back, Indian media. The entire population rose against the Indian media in particular. So, when you watch even, for example, 9/11, when it occurred, I don't think we saw any blood on the screens of CNN or, any broken bodies. It was very sophisticated, coverage. Now, we can challenge that, okay, CNN is not a good channel. People don't like it, or they find that their views are of a particular kind. But visually, do BBC or CNN or Al Jazeera show the kind of footage that we show here? So, keeping children's names, for example, anonymous is something that we often tell media people because children are children and they have a right to anonymity. So how do we ensure that we cover a story? For example, there was a story recently about that child at the railway platform where looking at his dead mother's body and trying to wake her up. Now, the thing is that what we advise media people is that if it was your child, would you be showing that child on national television in that situation? Because that child is innocent. Have you taken the child's consent to show the child in a particular situation like that? Because when the child grows up, will he or she like to be known as the child who had gone through that tragedy? So these are all personal things. So sensitivity, responsibility is what I would really urge every person who's getting into communication and media to take up. Because I also told you about empathy, because communication is not going to work by just using it for your own selfish methods. People are not going to tune in. Unless you can connect with what other people want to hear, what are their needs, communication is going to fail.
Yeah, so I would like to stop you here. Sorry for that. Thanks, Mr. Tak, for finally talking about some very vital thing, which as media educators, we always try to impart to our students that whatever communication you are doing, whichever platform, whichever media you are working, you have to be sensitive enough to the people and to the society. And this ethical aspect is really, really very, very vital in any kind of communication that we are doing in the media world. So I'm grateful to you that you touched upon this vital aspect. Thank you, Mr. Devendra Tak, to be with us and to talk to us on various aspects of communication in the development sector. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much.